It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
That was, of course, Neil Armstrong as the world sat mesmerized 52 years ago today. And this morning, a mission far closer to home, just about to the edge of space, but no less a giant leap for mankind.
Forget to look out the window.
Holy kid,
God.
Oh, wow.
Get in. Gotta get in. And touchdown. Welcome back, New Shepard's first human crew. What a flight.
Welcome back to Earth, first step. Congratulations to all of you.
That was, of course, Jeff Bezos, the world's richest man, using those Amazon billions to fund Blue Origin, building an automated spacecraft, which today blasted him, his brother, an 18-year-old from the Netherlands, and an 82-year-old aviation pioneer from Texas into space. Now the youngest and oldest space pioneers ever.
I want to thank every Amazon employee and every Amazon customer, because you guys paid for all of this. So seriously, for every Amazon customer out there and every Amazon employee, thank you from the bottom of my heart very much. It's very appreciated. Now, on to how it felt. Oh my God.
This was your dream. But for all those millions of Americans who are watching this, who are saying, this is a joyride, it has nothing to do with me.
Yeah.
What did you experience that matters to all Americans?
Well, listen, we have to build a road to space so that our kids and their kids can build the future. We need to take all heavy industry, all polluting industry, and move it into space and keep Earth as this beautiful gem of a planet that it is. Now, that's going to take decades and decades to achieve, but you have to start, and big things start with small steps.
That was Jeff Bezos in an exclusive interview with my colleague Stephanie Ruhle. And if Amazon is where his head is, it's evident that Blue Origin and the future of spaceflight is where Jeff Bezos' heart is. Joining us now are former NASA astronaut Dr. Mae Jemison. She became the first black woman to travel into space when she served as mission specialist aboard the space shuttle Endeavour. And we also have with us former NASA administrator and astronaut, Major General Charles Bolden. He's logged more than 680 hours in space and served on 4 space flights. It is a true honor to get to speak with you both. Major General Bolden, welcome back to the show. But I want to ask you both for your reaction to today's flight, this historic day for space travel, and what it really suggests about the future of space travel, starting with you, Dr. Jemison.
Well, first of all, I want to say hello, Charlie. How are you? It's great, always great to be on with you. So as far as I'm concerned, it was a great day. It was a wonderful launch. I was very excited about, yes, the crew, but also the engineering that was on display that built upon the road that had been established for a long period of time. And so this, for me, is an integration and next steps. It doesn't replace the work that we've been doing, but it's certainly next steps, and it's pretty wonderful. And it also is a nod to a lot of the work that General Bolden and Charlie did while he was NASA administrator, which helped us get comfortable with the idea of private human space launches.
Yeah. And Major General Bolden, to Dr. Jemison's point, I was really struck when the rocket booster landed softly on that pad via remote control. I mean, that really just took my breath away. Help us understand the differences in the space flight. We saw Bezos launch vertically today. A couple of days ago with Sir Richard Branson, he was sort of dropped into space from a different craft and then landed like an aircraft. What are the differences in those two approaches, and which one do you think will be the way that regular people get to space if we ever get to that point?
Yeah, we'll get to that point. Let me say hello to Mae again. It's always good to be with you, Mae, and Jeff. Great group. I'm going to be picky here for a moment. It didn't land by remote control. It actually landed. It was controlled on board. So it's an autonomous vehicle that has all that it needs to do to launch into space, come back and land. So technicality there. But I think that I'm like Mae. It's a culmination. And that's a bad word. It is. It's another step in the ever evolving process of maturing our technologies, actually looking at some of the ideas that Mae and her company are developing when we look at the 100-year Starship as an example. It is the evolution of humanity so that we can operate routinely is another word I don't like to use, but people can identify with it, so that we can operate routinely, whether it's here on the planet or in orbit or on another planet. So I am very optimistic. Mae knows me, has known me for a long time, and she knows that I'm the eternal optimist, so maybe I'm bad in that regard. But I actually see us putting humans in the Martian environment, if not on the surface of Mars, by the end of the next decade. So that means the 2030s. Wow. I said that this morning. Somebody seems startled. But that's the course on which we're presently marching. We'll get back on the lunar surface sometime before the end of this decade, and then in another 10 years, unless we have some dramatic interruption, I think we'll be in the Martian environment.
Wow. Dr. Jemison, what do you think about that? And what do you think about, or I should say, how should we think about democratizing access to space, given that ambitious timeline that Major General Bolden laid out?
So Charlie knows that. I think, you know, what has kept us off the moon, away from Mars, has really not been the technology. It's been public will and commitment to do it and putting the funding and things forward to it. And so really understanding what we need to do and how space benefits us. So I don't think the timeline is too ambitious. I think what we're seeing today is a recognition about how important space exploration is, how it impacts our world. Now, when we look at what just happened with Blue Origin, you know, it's all about the astronauts. It's all about the people who are going up. But really, what's going on is that there has been a lot of work underneath that, the engineers, mm-hmm. also the policymakers. So we have an opportunity to change things. Democratization, I think we have to be really careful, because right now, you know, a $250,000 plus ticket doesn't make it democratic necessarily. Charlie went up with NASA. I was the first woman of color in the world to go into space with a government agency, because it is our resource and we're building on that. So we have to be really careful about this. What concerns me about people saying private industry is coming and taking over is who are going to be the gatekeepers? Who are going to be the gatekeepers of access? Who are going to be the gatekeepers of technological development, of application of this resource that's really shared by humanity?
Such great points. Dr. Mae Jemison, Major General Charles Bolden, two true trailblazers. Thanks so much for your time.